will become commonplace and extraordinarily more prolific than they are right now. And is that a concern of yours? Are you aware of this worry?
No. Dr. Bernard Nathanson, I don't know if you're aware of him, he founded the organization NARAL. Okay. He came up with a figure that, you know, there's hundreds of thousands of women who are dying every year from illegal abortions. Mm-hmm. He's recanted that after he turned pro-life back in the mid-1980s. Mm-hmm. And the truth of the matter is, I mean, I can take you to men in Milwaukee right now who were doing the abortions prior to 1973. Mm-hmm. And then when it became legal, you know, they just put the shingle out in front.
Right. And do you think that their methods improved because the government has certain jurisdiction over what sort of medical practices they're implementing there? Whereas before, when it was illegal, I mean, you hear horror stories, obviously, I hope that this is exaggerated, of a folding table and a hanger.
Right. Most of them were exaggerated stories. There were horror stories.
Right.
But there was never any study done, so we can't know for sure.
Well, obviously,
there was never scientific
illegal
study done.
Right.
And so there's a lot of anecdotal stories.
Mm-hmm.
And
you don't give those really any credence?
No. To me, it's wrong to murder another human being.
Right.
So,
but you always said, though, that even if you made it illegal to murder another human being, it would still be going on.
Oh, sure. And that's true with any law. I mean, we have rapes illegal, but people still rape. You know, you always have people violating the law, regardless of what the law is.
And you're not too concerned, though, about the numbers of young women that who would be receiving an abortion? And would be having severe medical repercussions afterwards simply because it was illegal and they were forced to go to someone who was not, who didn't have a degree in medicine perhaps,
right,
who used very poor
treatment. Yeah, I would say don't do it, it's not right.
Right,
don't
but they're still going to be doing it.
But there's a lot of women harmed and injured in abortion.
Mm.
You know, their uteruses got perforated, the case just ended up in Milwaukee, they injected the woman with the same solution meant to kill her baby, and instead they injected into her blood system in 32 or 36 hours, she's dead.
Yeah, one of the things we do outside the abortion clinics is we keep track of all the lawsuits against the abortionists,
mm-hmm,
because like she said, there's many women still get damaged today.
Mm-hmm.
And we hand them a list of the lawsuits so that they can see this is the guy who's going to be operating on you, and look how many lawsuits he's already got against him.
I just, my biggest concern was that number would sort of increase of the women who are being caught. I was also curious, though, what are your arguments against abortion that don't involve religion? I wasn't here.
Well, just for me, as a man, when I see a little child being taken advantage of or killed like that, I mean, to me it's abhorrent. And just,
and
you know, if I didn't even have a Bible sitting in front of me,
mm-hmm,
just seeing someone who's helpless being taken advantage of by someone else. You know,
right.
I hear the abortionist goes in with the knife, the child's defenseless.
A knife?
In many cases, yeah. And cuts the baby's
knife
pieces.
Or a scalpel? When you say a knife, I'm thinking a large butcher
right
knife. You know,
scalpel.
Sort of coming at my vagina, and that really frightens
right
me. But, yeah.
Scalpel.
Okay,
and,
scalpel.
And, you know, and kills the baby. You know, to me, that person needs a defense, needs to be protected.
Okay. And keeping in mind that most abortions are done before the second trimester,
mm-hmm,
so that it doesn't actually have visible features yet.
Oh, it does.
Sure does.
The pictures that you had shown me, my mother's a nurse, and she'd informed me that the majority of those are second to third trimester.
Right.
Where, right.
They are. We use the first trimester, mm-hmm, in our literature. I don't know if you've seen our literature.
Oh, yeah. I picked up a lot of literature.
Yeah.
But
what I would do if I were you,
mm-hmm,
is, you know, just go get a medical textbook on fetal development. That's what convinced me. I saw the pictures,
okay,
and then I was like, man, I always thought it was just removal of some tissue. And then I went down to the public library to pull a medical textbook, mm-hmm, on fetal development and looked for myself. They start doing the surgical abortions at 7 weeks. Once in a while, it'll be done at 6 weeks. But you look at the babies there,
mm-hmm,
the majority are done between 8 and 12 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
You look at the babies that are being killed, they all have a human identifiable features, arms, legs, heads, rib cages, the whole bit, eyeballs.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, it's...
Yeah, I'll definitely look up the literature, but I would have trusted my mother's judgment being
yeah
a nurse.
Yeah, but I would encourage you, just go yourself. You can get a medical textbook on fetal development. All the libraries have it.
Martha.
I just have a couple questions. The first is for you, being a woman who has been here. Do you believe that the women that are currently getting abortions will be forgiven as well by your God?
If they repent,
obviously. And how would you repent?
I repent. repenting not only just from abortion, but from my sins of life.
I'm asking what is your definition of void about repenting?
Going before the Lord and saying, I'm sorry for the way I've lived my life. You know, I'm sorry for not just naming, you know, abortion, I lied. My whole life was I was separated from God. Not only sex and drinking or whatever, fornicating before I was married, and many sins. If they do that in a genuine, repentant manner, not just because there's women walk in the door and say, look, oh, well, I'll be forgiven, I'll just, when I'm out of here, then I'll just repent and be forgiven. That's what that's not the deep, true repentance that God would require of us.
It has to be a repentant to Jesus Christ?
Yes, I believe the only way to be saved and to spend eternity in heaven is through Jesus Christ.
Okay, and just my other question has, direct value to what occurs specifically on this campus. Something that I think this campus is really good at, and Andrew definitely is hearing all sides of the story. And I think, I guess this is almost specifically you guys, I think it upset people more that they were being touched, manhandled, chased, harassed, instead of just being allowed to accept your information, it was being forced upon them. And I'm just wondering what, especially, believing that you are Christians, you believe you're Christians, and people of God, what gives you the right, since you're not God, to force and to make other people feel so wrong in their doings, when maybe the only decision they have made against you is choosing not to take a pamphlet?
Well, I don't know who was chasing people or forcing people literature on people or anything like
many,
that.
Many of your missionaries were specifically touching, following, screaming, and that to me...
And I even took literature and I got yelled at.
I was just wondering what your feelings were on that.
No, I stand out there, you know, and I pass out literature all the time, and everybody else I see, I mean, some of our kids that we'll bring with us, I know they'll chase people, here, you want a piece of literature, you know, and but adults, I haven't seen anybody doing that. Maybe you could share.
Yeah, well, it was this one guy who was standing outside of the science building at the time when I was walking by, and one woman walked by and decided not to take literature. He followed her and was yelling things right at her, things like, there's no excuse for you women, and something along those lines, and he followed her all the way to the street and just right behind her yelling these things right at her. Probably that skinny, good looking. I don't know who it was. I mean, it was with your group certainly, but I don't know. I didn't get a name. So.
I have some male friends that were literally ready to hit people after they had touched them. And it was.
How did they touch them?
Touching them. No, come back here. Take this. Touching them. Getting physically. Okay. Hey, if you'd like me to, I can send it to you.
I would. If you could, I would. Yeah. Send it to me.
But
if you have it on video, I'd love to see it.
That's actually another question I was interested in asking. Why do you feel it necessary? I know I was basically leading the protest against people being harassed, especially in reference to the homosexual comments that were being made by the missionaries. And I know this is not the forum for that, so but I'm just letting you know the reason that we were out there. And your organization was videotaping us. And coming, when we first began, we were about 50 feet away from each one of your missionaries. By the time that we had been out there about an hour and a half, and there's probably a good 30 of us gathered, we were literally surrounded and being shouted at in our faces.
I was standing right there. Nobody surrounded you and was shouting at you.
There were people.
You were all lined up in a line singing, right?
We shall overcome.
We shall overcome. I was standing across the street. And I was standing next to you for a while.
There were people that were standing